Right, let's do this thing.
What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening. What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening. What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening. What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening.
I'm going downtown tonight.
What's going on?
So, as I said a little bit earlier, ladies and gentlemen, every single city in this land will be holding its pantomime. Pantomime time, ladies and gents, and just to reiterate, they're at the Stute Theatre up until the 31st of December. They are going to be doing Jack and the Beanstalk. Jack and the Beanstalk starring Ibiza Weekender, Jordan Davis, good-looking lad. And also as well, Theatre Clwyd are doing their normal rock and roll panto this year. It's a wee belter. It's called Dick Whittington and it's cracking brilliant. And also as well, Theatre Clwyd, as we heard earlier, are doing Hansel and Gretel. It's one for the younger kids there, but the, you know, mums and dads can go as well. It's fantastic. It's fantastic. But over in Sheffield, ladies and gents, over at the Sheffield Lyceum, they are doing Peter Pan. Peter Pan this year for them, and this year it stars Shaun Williamson from Eastenders and the Extras, of course. Wendi Peters, we all know from Coronation Street, and the Sheffield legend Damian Williams, Gemma Hunt from CBeebies Swashbuckle, and David Ribi, I'm not sure how you pronounce that, Sonny Dave, from Milkshake. So, I contacted Shaun Williamson, as I say, from EastEnders, playing the part of Barry in EastEnders for 10 whole years. And then went on to do many, many, many things, including the brilliant Extras done by Ricky Gervais. And, well, not many people know this, but Janet, our in-house guest today, you actually are good friends with Shaun, aren't you? You were in college with Shaun.
Yeah, we were in college together.
You were, and, so, I mean, it's great, isn't it, when you've got friends who have done well?
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people think that, I mean, there is a lot of jealousy in this business, but when you see somebody who is actually a mate...
Yeah.
Doing well,
and
then you.
Nice bloke as well.
Yeah, very
really nice.
Very nice bloke, and that's about to be highlighted here in this brilliant interview. You haven't heard this interview, have you?
No, I'm a bit gutted actually that I was out when you spoke to him.
Yeah.
Because it would have been nice to catch up.
Yeah, that really is a really nice fella, and you also come up in this conversation a few times, yeah. So here we go, ladies and gentlemen, live on Calon FM on the Stage and Screen Show. Here he is, Mr. Shaun Williamson. Enjoy this.
Andrew.
How are you, my man? How are you?
How are you? You're okay?
Fantastic. Yeah, great. Great to speak to you. How are you doing?
Yeah, all good. Yeah, yeah. Just day off today, so.
Oh, fantastic. You stay in Sheffield when you're off?
Yeah, well, I will today. I'll make the effort. What happened was my wife drove up the first week, she drove up the second week. This week, we're not bothering, and then I'll drive home. Christmas Eve and New Year's Eve.
Right.
And then I'll come back and then it'll all be over by the sixth.
Cool. So I always see pantomime as a sort of bit of an end-of-term blowout for actors. Would that be fair?
I'll tell you what it is. I think this is my 15th panto on the bounce. And it's great fun. I mean, you get to really do a bit of everything, really, sort of singing, dancing, acting, and even in my case, being a villain, a bit of sword fighting.
Yeah.
And you don't often get to sword fight in this business, even though you're taught it at drama school. And I've got my little certificate on the wall, you know. It's so much fun, and it's a really handy way to pay your tax bill in January.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Very handy indeed. And also, I don't think I'd know what to do with a Christmas off now. I think I'd just put on 6 stone and, you know, drink myself to death. So it's good, you know. It just sort of means that you're working hard and keeping the weight off and...
Yeah.
Yeah, having fun and paying your tax, really.
Yeah, marvellous. So do you kind of approach it as, I mean, it looks like a whole lot of fun, but, we both know it's a lot of hard work, but do you approach it like you would any other production, or is there a more of a sort of a light-hearted approach to it?
Yeah, there is a light-hearted approach to it, but at the end of the day, when we arrived in Sheffield on, I think it was the 25th of November, and we rehearsed for 6 days, and then we had the Saturday off. And then when we came back in Sunday, we did one more day of acting, and then we were into the tech. So we're putting on what is basically a musical with about 15 different musical numbers in it, and, and lots of loads of fights and all sorts of things, and dance routines, and you've got 6-7 days to rehearse that, really. So although there's room for a laugh purely because of the content of what it is, a lot of it's dark. You know, it's deadly serious in that you've got very little time to put it on.
Yeah.
You know. And also, knocking on now, I'm just turned 54, so my knees are, I'm having more fun than my knees.
Yeah, right, OK. And you're playing Hook, are you?
I am, so I'm playing Captain Hook, third year on the trot. This is for Evolution Pantomimes, who are based in Kent, but they've got pantos all over the country. So I did it for them 2 years ago in Crawley, and then I did it last year in Canterbury, and then this year, all six cast members that were in Canterbury came up to reprise their roles. So Damian Williams, the legendary dame of Sheffield at Lyceum, he was the only person who hadn't done the show. So that helped in rehearsals, because six of us did it from last year.
Right, OK. And what in your opinion, makes for a good pantomime? Is there any ingredient that needs to be there?
To me, just the script. The script's got to be good. I mean, that's why I love working for Evolution. Paul Hendy's scripts are excellent. They're just great scripts. And I also work for another company when I don't work for Paul, because Jordan Pantomimes, his scripts are excellent. I've done some pantomimes for some really quite big companies, and their script has never come up to this script. It's all script-based, it has to be.
Yeah.
And then it comes out, obviously, down to the casting. So it was so good to know this year that five of the people that did it with last year were in it.
Yeah.
And... yeah, apart from that, just a lot of hard work, really.
Yeah. All right, brilliant. Let me ask you about the quizzes, right? Because I've noticed over the last 20 years or so since I've known you, you've been on most of the big TV quiz shows, and you always seem to be awesome on them. So are you naturally a quizzer? Do you enjoy quizzing?
I got into it right from the word go when the Trivial Pursuit craze hit back in the mid 80s.
Right.
And it did become a bit of a passion. I love a quiz. I like second them, actually. I normally do a panto quiz. I'll probably do one at the end for the cast and staff. But yeah, I've been very lucky. I've managed to get on and win most of the shows. I was very lucky enough to win Mastermind and Eggheads and The Chase and Pointless, yeah.
Yeah. Well, you got the record at the time, I remember, on The Chase, didn't you? You
were what?
You got the record at the time. I think the amount.
The record amount, I think I got something like 70 or 80 grand, but I think since then, I think Bill Tufnell took 120 grand back. But
yeah.
I think it depends how well... I think it depends if you go on last and how well the rest of your team have done, how much they offer you, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it was great fun, because we managed to beat the Beast.
Yeah.
And we got the money out of the money out of the building, which is great.
Have you not been on any that you'd really like to do yet?
I'd love to do that. The Million Pound Drop with Davina McCall. I'd love to get on that one.
Oh yeah.
And also, there's loads of new ones coming up all the time. There's one on a weekday night on BBC One now. I can't remember the name of it. That's not very helpful. But I'd love to get on Only Connect with Victoria Cora Mitchell.
Oh, that's a show. That's hard, yeah. That show.
University Challenge, but I've had that because I never went to uni. Unless I do a University of Life.
Yeah, drama school challenge. I wonder where that would go down. Yeah. There's a new one, isn't there, with Richard Osman? Is that the one you're thinking of? Richard Osman.
Oh, House of Games.
House of Games.
Yeah, I'd love to get on that as well.
Good game, that is. Yeah, but that's not necessarily general knowledge, is it? That's a bit of everything. That's a good game.
Oh,
that.
Is it? Oh, I'll be stuffed at that one.
Yeah, and talking of training, because you, I suppose a lot of people are surprised to learn that you were actually in the Navy before you trained as an actor.
Well, yeah, acting wasn't my first love. I mean, there was absolutely no tradition of acting in our family whatsoever. My dad was a postman, mum was a cleaner, and I left school at 16. I literally just turned 16, and they let me leave school because there was a recession at the time in 1981, and they let me leave school to get a job as a telegram boy. On the condition that I went back and did my exams. So I was a postman for 3 years, then I got bored of that and joined the Navy. I joined up as an aircraftman in something called the Fleet Air Arm. But they did the medical, unbelievable, and you think that'd be the first thing they did. And found that I was colourblind. So that put paid to anything remotely interesting that you can do in the Navy, really. So then you have to either be you know, you have to work in the stores or work in an office or be a cook. Not as anything wrong with that job, you know.
Yeah.
Please don't think there is. But it didn't suit me, so I chose to be a writer, which is basically a glorified pay clerk. Don't ask me why. Well, I'd already got my head around the idea of going in, you see, and I thought, well, I'm going in. Because yeah. I told everyone I was going in. And I lasted just over a year because it was just so boring. And I was right, because not long after that, faxes came in to be followed by all sorts of things, which meant you just didn't need a pay accountant at sea. You know, you don't need someone in an office at sea now. It's just it's all done on emails and all sorts of things like that, and automated bank payments. So I made the right decision.
Yeah.
And then I left the Navy, and then I sort of drifted for a while, really. I had some great summer jobs. I was a Pontus Blue Coat, and I was an 1830 club rep, but I can't remember anything about that. And I worked for 2 years in America with handicapped children, and it was all great fun, but every Christmas would find me back in Maidstone, sat in the shelf or drinking too much. And then luckily one day someone said to me, look, why don't you go down the local amateur dramatic group? I heard that they're short of particularly young men, they're always short of young men actors down there, because young men are obviously a bit more reserved. So I went down there, and I found I had a certain knack for it, and worked hard and tried to get into the big drama schools in London, and they said no. And then I worked hard for another year, and then eventually a drama school took me on at 27.
Yeah.
And I studied at Webber Douglas, met your lovely wife there.
You did indeed, yeah.
Yeah.
And it was. And it was just, I mean, amazing, really, that you, just immediately after you left college, or so it seemed, you got a small part in EastEnders playing an ambulance man. Am I making that?
Yeah. I think they were still called that then, before they toughened up their image to paramedics.
That's right.
and it all became very American.
Yeah.
And then, I drifted in and out of a few jobs, like London's Burning and The Bill and Inspector Morse, worked with the late, great John Thor. And then, 6 months later, they said, would you like to come in as Barry? I mean, I had to go and audition for it and all that. But and again, that sort of, it took its while to get going. Poor old Barry, I mean, first couple of years, they didn't really know what to do with him. I think they wanted him to be a bit of a villain. Ended up in prison and set fire to the car lot. But I think there's something about me that isn't particularly villainous. My comical side always come through. So then they eventually, a lovely actor called Paul Bradley left, who played Nigel, and they needed a fat funny man, and they shifted me into that role, really.
Yes, yeah. I wouldn't have put it like that, but I know what you mean. So you were there for like 10 years.
Yeah.
And so how does it work contractually? Do you have to sign a contract every year to stay, or how does it work?
Yeah, at first, you see, it's very frustrating because I didn't know what to do with me, so I was signing up for sort of 10 episodes at a time and this, that and the other, and it was really going nowhere. And I remember being particularly miserable in 1996 because it looked like nothing was happening. And then I think late 97, early 98, I got my first what I call proper contract, and that was like for a year. They used to guarantee you 75 episodes.
God.
But then you got paid for the repeat on the Sunday, you see.
Oh, lovely.
You got two-thirds of your money again, so, you know. So if you only made 60, they'd pay you the extra 15, but you wouldn't get the repeat fee. But if you made 120, you made 120 happy days, you know.
Yeah.
They'd guarantee you 75. And then towards the end, the last couple of years, I was on two-year contracts, so that was good. But all good things come to an end, and, you know, 10 years is enough. By the time I left at 40, I'd spent a quarter of my life in it, so, you know, I was quite happy to move on.
But that is the amazing thing, isn't it? When you, the older you get, and if 10 years in something, you think, oh, well, that's not that long, because it didn't seem that long at the time. But 10 years, that's a decade. That's a long chunk of your life, isn't it?
And it was great fun, and I had my children during that decade, and, you know.
Yeah.
But I was happy to move on and do lots of other things.
So when you just got killed off at the end, is that like a bit of a punch to the gut, or is it a bit of a blessing?
No. Everyone I know, you know, who's left normally, they're just dying to get back in, whether it's for money or, you know, but as soon as you know you can't, you get your head around that and just move on and, you know.
Yeah.
You know, I've been lucky. I've never really been out of work, not what I call chronically out of work in 14 years, so I've been very lucky.
Because, and also as well, it led to an almost genius casting with Ricky Gervais in The Extras.
Well, the genius totally being on their side, him and Stephen, but I was so lucky to be approached by them, and I assume they enjoyed EastEnders. I didn't even know that they'd watch it, but I'd like The Office, and the call come out of the blue, and I said, yeah, I'll be in it. He warned me I was going to get the mic taken out of it, but then he said everyone does, even himself. So Yeah, you had to hang your ego up at the door before you went in. But, yeah, it was a lovely job, you know. And it kept the ball in the air, because you can vanish. It kept the ball in the air for a couple of years, because then they put me in something called Life's Too Short with Warwick Davis.
Uh-huh.
And he gave me a small part in a film called The Invention of Lines. So I owe them a lot, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, but I think it's, it does say a lot about yourself that you're willing to go and basically send yourself up, play yourself, essentially, which...
Yeah, but I went along to meet them, and they showed me a list of people who'd agreed, and when you see the names of, you know, yeah. some of the people who'd agreed to send themselves up,
yeah.
do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, well, the least I can do is do it myself. Ben Affleck, who was in it?
Yeah, list is endless, isn't it?
But... Ben Stiller, Dame Diana Rigg, I mean,
yeah.
Robert De Niro, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah, and it was, I mean, it was... It was such a simple idea, but brilliant as well that even like your own agent gets you confused with your soap character. It was just amazing.
Very clever. They're very clever men. Luckily, I've just made another sitcom called Mr. Winner.
Right.
And that's due out on BBC One at 8:30 at night in March, I think.
All right, cool.
That'd be good to get back out in something contemporary. So, and I mean, 21 episodes of a quiz show with Al Murray as a sort of sidekick. Something called Al Murray's Great British Pub Quiz. So, making 21 of those as well. So, that'll be out in March as well. But he'd be sick of the sight of me. You know, I'm dead. They'll get sick of me all over again.
Listen, before you go, let me ask you about Big Brother, because ironically last week I had old Jordan Davis on my show, and you were both in at the same time on Celebrity Big Brother.
Lovely fella, and I was very lucky because I'd seen some series and they were just horrific. My late great friend Keith Chegwin was in with a couple of creatures called Paris Hilton.
Yeah.
Katie Hopkins.
Uh-huh.
It was vile.
Yeah.
And then there was someone called Bear in 1 year.
Yeah.
You know, and it was vile. And I thought, oh, God. But I was so lucky, mainly because the younger people gave me a lot of respect. Jordan being one of them, he's a gentleman. And,
yeah. He spoke fondly of you, too.
Yeah, he's a lovely, lovely man. And a couple of nights, obviously, they played up and had a late one and did that. But, you know, so what?
Yeah.
Basically, I was given a lot of respect, he's a lovely fella. I hope he's doing well. Is he still putting it about in Ibiza?
He's just about to go back, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, but he's doing the local panto in Wrexham, so...
get reincarnated, I want to come back with his fingertips.
Oh dear! Because I always got the impression that by the time you actually went on Big Brother, because you'd been on the Big Brother's Big Mouth so many times, I mean, I even said to Janet, I'm sure Sean's been on this.
Yeah, because I love Ryland and I think his show's great. So I went on about 14 times, I think, and I used to sing with Rusty Lee. They had a suggestion of me and Rusty Lee being duet.
Yeah.
And it was great fun. It's great fun, as I say. I'll do anything for a laugh as long as it's not totally desperate. And it was good fun and get paid and have a lovely night. So I'm sad it's gone, but, you know, it's just the way it is. I think it needs just rest and come back with a new format or something, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it just needs revamping a little bit.
Yeah.
It's sort of losing its way a little bit, I thought. I like the celebrity ones, the normal ones. I just couldn't get into it at all.
They just go on forever as well, don't they?
Yeah.
I mean, they're in there for a long time. Proper brain damage time, that is. I mean, to be in there for, it was like 3 months, isn't it?
Yeah. I know. I couldn't.
I did 23 nights, it was enough for me.
Yeah. Was it a lot different than you imagined it would be, or...?
I mean, nothing can prepare you for it. It's like the hardest thing for me was that at night, I was so lucky because Keith Chegwin said to me, get your own bed. Just get your agent to say you want your own bed.
Yeah.
And I was sharp enough to do that, and so did, I think, who won it. Sarah Harding from Girls Aloud. I think everyone else shared, right, at some point.
Right.
And I couldn't think of anything worse. I mean, Paul Danan was in a room with some big American called Chad, you know.
Yeah.
You know, I couldn't think of anything worse. And, but at night, the lights went out, obviously, but only when the last person had come to bed, because that could be 4 a.m, but you don't know because there isn't a clock in there, you see.
Yeah.
So the lights go out. Now, when you wake up in the morning, if you wake up at 7 a.m, you know you haven't got to be up till 9, you snuggle down again, didn't you, because you know you've got a couple of hours.
Yeah.
When you wake up, you haven't got a clue what the time is, you haven't got a clue what time the light's going to come on. It's really weird. So you just lie there somewhere and you're just waiting for the light to come on, and it comes on really brightly, like in a prison. And they play this loud music through the speakers. So, yeah, the mornings weren't good. But unlike the jungle in the evening, you know, there was plenty of booze because they want you to loosen up, you see.
Yeah.
So that's the best thing about it, as opposed to the jungle or something. You eat well, and unless you're all being punished for something, and you get a fair bit of booze in the evening. So that was all right.
But what about I'm a Celebrity? Would you ever fancy doing that?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, to be paid to lose 2 stone.
I would if I was in your position, I would love to do I'm a Celebrity. It really speaks to me.
And the big difference is in Big Brother. They want negativity.
Yeah.
So I was told before I went in, if there's an argument, get involved, you know, don't hold back, get stuck in, and I'm just not like that anyway.
Yeah.
Whereas in the jungle, the positivity and teamwork is celebrated, and you don't have to vote for each other, so, you know, there's none of that aggro going on. So I think what I'm good at would come across in a more positive light than in Big Brother, where they just didn't put me in the edit.
I know what you mean. Difference. Yeah, absolutely. It's been an absolute treat speaking to you, mate.
Pleasure, Andrews. Let's do it again in another 22 years.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
The last time I saw you, mate, 1996.
Yeah, it was. Well, we came round your place and we were supposed to repay the compliment, and Janet was really ill. Yeah, she'd, I don't know, she was working on a boat on, she was rehearsing for something on a boat on the Thames, one of them on the embankment, and she just got motion sickness or something. She was terrible.
Well, I think me and you were incredibly sympathetic, but it didn't stop us
getting drunk. That's true. You take care of yourself, have a great run in the pants.
All the best, mate.
All the best, man. All, have a lovely Christmas.
Oh, well, thank you.
Cheers. So there you go, that's Shaun Williamson. He is starring in Peter Pan as Hook, and that's going to be running until the 6th of January up there at the Sheffield Lyceum Theatre. Tickets 0114, this is the box office number, yeah? 0114 249 6000, 0114 249 6000, or just go to the webpage www.sheffieldtheatres.co.uk/Peter Pan. What a lovely fella. Hang on, let's bring Janet back in. What did you think? What did you think of that?
Oh, that was just like, it was reminiscent of old times. He is he's such a nice bloke.
Nice fella. Really, like, yeah. Top of the draw. Because a lot of people, when they go on telly and they change, yeah, and they're a bit sort of
it's
horrible.
Like you were saying before, you know, about jealousy within profession and that. Do you know what? If I'm thinking of people in my year, I'm so pleased he worked.
Yep.
And quizzes. He used to do quizzes. He used to set quizzes in college.
Oh, really?
He was always, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, he's good on the quizzes, isn't
he? Yeah, he is.
I mean, because a lot of people think that the celebrity versions of these quizzes are a lot easier. I think they are a little bit easier as well. Yeah, because so they can sort of, you know, make more money and give it to charity. I think that's the theory, but my theory anyway. But he still doesn't stop him winning the damn thing. I mean, he's still got to do it.
He was always good.
Yeah.
He was like, everybody likes Shaun.
Yeah, yeah. Nice lad. Yeah. Brilliant. I'm so pleased to have got Shaun on our last show of the year. And it's actually a very long list of terrific interviews I've had this year. If you want to check them out, they're on my YouTube page. I've put like a podcast thing together. And it's Andy Roo is the name of my page. Andy Roo. That's Andy, right? R-O-O-Roo, right? Check them out. We've got Dave Hill from Slade. These are the recent ones. Meryl Osmond from the Osmonds. Stephen K. Amos, comedian. Max Boyce is there. Comedian. Vicky Stone. And who else we got here? Oh, John Lydon as well. That was one, wasn't it? And Chubby Brown. I had Chubby Brown as well. Oh, my God. It was amazing. Go ahead. Support your local theatres, ladies and gentlemen. They won't be there forever if you don't.